Good morning, everybody. Pleasure to be here. GDP is declining all over the world, everywhere. And the reason is productivity has been declining all over the world for the last 20 years. And the result is unemployment's very high in every region of the world. Our economists today are projecting 20 more years of low productivity and slow growth. It's clear we're in the sunset of one of the great industrial eras. But now, this industrial revolution of the 19th and 20th century has given rise to a much more profound crisis. We are in real-time climate change. And what's so devastating about climate change is it changes the water cycles of the Earth. It's never described. We're the watery planet. Our ecosystems have developed over millions of years based on the water cycles around the Earth. For every 1 degree the temperature is going up on this planet from global warming emissions, the atmosphere is sucking up 7% more precipitation from the ground, so we're getting more concentrated precipitation in the clouds in more extreme water events, more extreme snows in the winter, more extreme floods in the spring, more extreme droughts and wildfires in the summer, more Category 3, 4, and 5 hurricanes. We had 4 hurricanes hit the United States in the last month, devastation, deaths, infrastructure, and we've got California burning this morning, burning from drought. Our scientists tell us that our ecosystems are collapsing from the runaway exponential water curves. And this is what I want every parent in this room to listen to, please. Our scientists tell us we're in the 6th extinction event of life on Earth. The other 5 happened well before humans were here. And they say at the present rate, we are going to lose over half the species of life on this little planet in the next 8 decades. That's the decades of your grandchildren. The last time we had an extinction event of this magnitude was 65 million years ago. We're talking about 8 decades. We are asleep. We are literally asleep. We need a new economic vision for the world. It needs to be compelling. We need a game plan to deliver on the vision. It needs to move quick. We have to be off a carbon-based civilization by mid-century if we're going to avoid the abyss. So we need to step back and ask this question. How do the great economic paradigm shifts in history occur? If we know how they occur, we're going to get a roadmap and a compass here in Canada and around the world, and we're going to chart a new journey quickly. There have been at least 7 major economic paradigm shifts in history. They're interesting because they share a common denominator. At a moment of time, 3 defining technologies emerge in a civilization and they converge to create what we call in engineering a general purpose technology platform, an infrastructure that fundamentally transforms the way a society manages, powers, and moves economic and social activity. What are those 3 technologies? Number 1, new communication technologies to more efficiently manage the economic activity. Number 2, new sources of energy to more efficiently power that economic activity. And number 3, new modes of mobility to more efficiently move the economic activity. When communication revolutions converge with new energy regimes and new modes of mobility, it does change the way society manages, powers, and moves its economic and social life. It changes our temporal-spatial orientation. It changes our economic models. Changes governance, it even changes consciousness. 2 examples. 19th century, first industrial revolution, Britain. 20th century, second industrial revolution, the United States. The Brits take us into a new convergence of communication, energy, and mobility. Steam power printing, no more manual print presses. Big leap forward in productivity and efficiency. Then they lay out a telegraph system, the last part of the 19th century. Those communication revolutions converge with a new energy regime. Cheap coal. Then they put together the steam engine to harvest it, and then they put the steam engine on rails for locomotives and national transport. 20th century, second industrial revolution in the United States, similarly, convergence of communication, energy, and mobility. The telephone, it was as big a deal as the internet today. Later, radio and television, and they converged in the U.S. with a new energy source, cheap Texas oil. Then Henry Ford put everyone on the road, cars, buses, and trucks. That second industrial revolution took the entire world through the 20th century, and it peaked in July 2008 when Brent crude oil hit $147 a barrel that month. The whole global economy shut down. That was the great earthquake of the Second Industrial Revolution and the collapse of the financial market 60 days later. That was simply an aftershock, because this whole civilization is made out of fossil fuels. Fertilizers, pesticides, construction materials, synthetic fiber, pharmaceutical products, transportation, light, it's all made out of and moved by fossil fuels. It is clear we're in the sunset of this energy era. Does anyone in the room think we're in the sunrise of fossil fuels? So where do we go from here? Let me share an anecdote. When Angela Merkel became Chancellor of Germany, she asked me to come to Berlin in the first couple of weeks of her government to help her address the question of how do we grow the German economy and create jobs. You've been there the whole time. This was an amazing process. So when I got to the Chancellor's office, the first thing I said to her is, Madam Chancellor, how do you grow the German economy when your businesses are plugged into a second industrial revolution infrastructure of centralized telecommunication, fossil fuel nuclear power, internal combustion transport, and that infrastructure to manage power and move Germany peaked in its aggregate efficiency and productivity about 10 years ago. And we have the numbers. It peaked in all the industrial countries, the aggregate efficiency, somewhere between the mid-1990s and 2005. So I said, you can have market reforms, labor reforms, fiscal reforms, and you can incentivize all sorts of entrepreneurs. It won't make any difference if they're plugged into this old infrastructure, because they can't get any more productivity out of it to manage power and move their businesses. So on that first day, we talked about a third industrial revolution, a new convergence of communication, energy, and mobility to manage power and move Germany. At the end of the day, the Chancellor says, we will have this third industrial revolution for Germany. Here's what's happening. We are moving to a third and last industrial revolution. It's a digital revolution, convergence of communication, energy, and mobility to manage power and move the world. The internet's here, 25 years since the World Wide Web, big communication revolution. Everyone in the room has a smartphone, correct? We're connected. Pretty soon the whole human race will be connected. Now this digitalized communication internet is just now beginning to converge with a digitalized renewable energy internet, so that millions and soon hundreds of millions and soon everyone on the planet will be able to harvest their own solar, wind, and other renewable energy locally, share it off-grid, or send it back to an energy internet that's digitalized across entire continents. These two internets, the communication internet already here, the renewable energy internet starting in Germany and across Europe, China, is now converging with a third internet, a digitalized GPS and soon driverless road, rail, water, and air internet, in which the vehicles are electric and fuel cell, operating by near zero marginal cost renewable energy. These three internets to manage power and move society, they ride on top of a platform called the Internet of Things. We are putting sensors in all our devices so they can send real data back and talk to us and other machines. By 2030, we will have a ubiquitous interconnected planetary system. This is a global brain. This is a nervous system. And what this means is that the whole human race is going to be able to come together, we already are, and be able to share our economic destiny and our social life in a diverse family at very low to near zero marginal cost. This means a vast expansion of social entrepreneurialism and economic democracy, because we can eliminate a lot of the middlemen and vertically integrated organizations that kept the 1% from the 99%. While it's exciting, it's also frightening. There's the dark net. How do we ensure network neutrality when everyone's connected? How do we assure everyone has access? How do we ensure governments don't purloin this for political purposes, as in hacking the US elections? How do we ensure data security and privacy when everyone's connected? How do we ensure that big companies like Google and Facebook don't monopolize this internet and commodify our data for third parties? And how do we provide against cybercrime and cyberterrorism? Every week there's new malware. This is the dark net. We're going to have to spend as much time and effort on the dark net as the bright net, or we won't get to the promised land. But let me say for this morning, three decades of struggle, maybe we can handle this. Here's the advantage of the bright net. Everybody in Canada, you have a value chain, whether you're a small business or a co-op or a nonprofit, a neighborhood association, a local government. You're managing your power and you're moving your activity each day. You can go up on this emerging Internet of Things platform, it's already emerging, and have a transparent picture of all the data that's flowing through the system if it stays open. Then you can take the data you care about from your value chain, from your business, strip it out. And just with a cheap mobile phone, you can mine that big data with your own analytics, create your own apps. So you can dramatically increase your aggregate efficiency and your productivity, dramatically plunge your marginal cost in managing, powering, and moving your business. The marginal costs are going to get so low from digitalization that it forces a shift in capitalism itself, because when the marginal costs get really low, you got less profit. So capitalism is in a stage of a transition of moving from capitalist markets to capitalist networks, from ownership to access, from sellers and buyers to providers and users on networks. Some of the marginal costs are getting so low they're heading to near zero, and that's given rise to the sharing economy, which we're all talking about. This little baby was birthed by capitalism. It's the first new economic system to enter onto the world stage since capitalism and socialism, so it's a fairly remarkable event. We already have 3.5 billion people in the sharing economy at near zero marginal cost. Today, this morning, there are millions of people up on the web. They're producing and sharing their own music. What does it cost? You have a little digital recorder, and you can send it to 1 billion people, and all you need is a service provider, no cost. We have people at any given time of the day producing and sharing their own news blogs, their own social media. They're taking their cell phones, making little films. They're putting it out on the web at no cost. They are contributing to Wikipedia, constructing the knowledge of the world, freely giving their talent, zero marginal cost. And we got millions of kids taking open online courses from colleges taught by the best professors near zero marginal cost. Whole industries have been disrupted. Music, newspaper, television, book publishing. But thousands of new businesses have emerged, not just Google and Facebook and Twitter. Thousands of businesses, they're creating the platforms, the apps, the connections. It is a disruption. We thought there'd be a firewall, and that while digital marginal costs would affect the virtual world, we didn't think it would go to the physical world. The Internet of Things broke the firewall. We now have millions of people producing their own solar and wind at near zero marginal cost. And we now have millions of young people sharing car services, and within 5 years, those are going to be autonomous vehicles, they're going to be electric, they're going to be fuel cell, they're going to head to zero marginal cost with drones. Let's go back to Germany and what you've done. You've done a spectacular job. What are you, 34% of your electricity now is solar and wind? You're going to be 100% before 2040. And we were talking before we came up, it's going to be in the paint. They're putting the solar in the glass, in the facades. Everyone's going to be producing their own solar and wind. But here's what's interesting, the fixed cost. Solar and wind have been on an exponential plunging curve in fixed costs for 20 years, just like computers. Computers used to cost millions of dollars. But then Moore's Law set in, and Intel was able to double the capacity on those chips every 2 years. Now we have smartphones for $25. Solar and wind have been on the same curve. Some of you older folks remember that a solar watt fixed cost, $78. Fixed cost, 1 watt, 1979. It isn't $78 this morning, it's 55 cents. Yeah, it's heading to 35 cents in the next 2 years from now, and we have now power and utility companies in Europe and America in the last 12 months that are now buying 20-year contracts, solar and wind, right now, 4 cents a kilowatt hour. If you're in the energy industry, you just heard something that's a game changer. So solar and wind fixed costs are becoming competitive, and that exponential curve keeps dropping, dropping, dropping. And the big news is stranded assets. Citibank put out a report last year saying we have $100 trillion now in stranded assets in the fossil fuel industry. It's the biggest bubble in history. The power companies are aware of it. I meet with the CEOs all over the world every year, every month. This is a disruption as dramatic as what happened to music, television, newspapers. It's much more dramatic, actually. But what's interesting is once you pay those fixed costs, which are plummeting, the marginal costs are near zero. The sun has not sent us a bill in Germany. The wind hasn't invoiced us. They're free. What happens when German businesses plug in and European businesses plug into a third industrial revolution, 5G communication, helping manage the data on the energy internet, and those businesses on every single conversion to manage power and move their business, the energy cost is near zero marginal cost. When you project ahead, how does a second industrial revolution country compete with that with fossil fuel and nuclear power? Who's producing the new energy? There are four major power companies in Germany, EnBW, RWE, E.ON, Vattenfall. We thought they were invincible 11 years ago, but what happened to them is what happened to the music industry and newspapers and book publishing and television. It's called digitalization of energy. Small players across Germany set up their electricity cooperatives. They all got loans from the banks. The banks knew they'd pay back on the energy they're producing, and now we can take the feed-in tariffs and knock them out because we're now competitive. The big four power companies are producing 4% of this energy, I believe it is, and 96% is being produced by small cooperatives. The big companies can't scale it because you got to catch the sun everywhere. You got to catch the wind everywhere. You can't do it in a few centralized spots. Now, does this mean this is the end of the power companies? No. But they have to make a transition and be in two portfolios over 40 years. This isn't tomorrow. But we have a disruption here today, and smart power companies are now having to make a shift and be in two businesses, their legacy business, second industrial revolution, not going to disappear tomorrow, but also be in their sunrise businesses in the same time. So 5 years ago, E.ON, one of the big four power companies, asked if I would debate their chairman, Mr. Tyson. He's still there. And what I said in the debate is, while you're not leaving the second industrial revolution, these are legacy businesses, fossil fuel and nuclear. They're going to be here for a while. But you have to have a new portfolio, and in the new portfolio, you won't generate any electricity. We're all going to do that in our cooperatives. What you're going to do is help manage energy services, and you're going to set up partnerships with thousands of businesses. And as a power and utility company, you'll help manage the energy through their value systems. You'll help them with their analytics, their big data. So those thousands of businesses can increase their aggregate efficiency, spike their productivity, reduce their ecological footprint, and reduce their marginal cost. In return, those thousands of businesses that you contract with, if you're a utility company, they're going to share their productivity gains back with you, the power company. It's called performance contracts. 5 years ago, he said no, and as you know, this last year he said yes. And he put his fossil fuel and nuclear power on the market, but there's no bidders. It's a stranded asset. And he's moving to energy services. RWE has joined this, the other big power company. They have two companies, their legacy business, fossil fuel nuclear, energy services. GDF Suez, now called Engie, same thing. ERDF, EDF, the nuclear power in France, have joined us in northern France. We are laying out plans, our global team, we're in all of northern France now, the Netherlands, Luxembourg. And ERDF has joined us in northern France, they're laying out the energy internet. They're not leaving nuclear, but they realize they have to be in two models. It's not just Europe, now China. I was quite surprised when Premier Xi, Chairman Xi came in and Premier Li put out his biography. He said he had read the Third Industrial Revolution. I had never met him. And he instructed the central government of China to begin working on this narrative that we're talking about this morning. They moved very quick. I started to do visits to China with the leadership, but 11 weeks after the first visit, to show you how quick they move, the chairman of the state grid announced an $82 billion commitment in the new five-year plan to completely digitalize the state grid so that millions of Chinese people buying their own solar and wind from their own companies can produce it local, share it across a completely digitalized energy internet. That's now being operationalized in the five-year plan currently underway. The coming together of the communication internet with the digitalized energy internet makes room for the mobility internet. We built the whole world on making and selling cars, but the millennials have thrown us a curve. They just don't want to own cars that's grandma and grandpa. They want car sharing in networks, not ownership of vehicles in markets. And for every car shared in this digital era, we're eliminating 15 cars from production. The auto companies know this. We've seen studies that suggest that we will eliminate 80% of the vehicles in the world. There are 1 billion vehicles, cars, buses, and trucks, choking us in traffic, number 3 cause of climate change. Number 1 is buildings. We're going to retrofit them and turn them into big data centers. Number two, we never talk about is beef production and consumption, animal husbandry. If we don't talk about that, we're lost. That's number two. And number three is vehicles. We're going to eliminate 80% of them probably. The other 20% are going to be electric. They're going to be fuel cell. They're going to be 3D printed. The car companies are already doing it with recycled material. And they're going to be driverless within 5 years at near zero marginal cost. Does this mean the end of the transport industry? No, but they have to change their business model, just like the power companies over 30 years. It's exciting if you're not paralyzed. So Daimler, I've joined with Daimler and Ford. So Wolfgang Bernhard's the chairman of Daimler Trucks. He asked me to come in last year. We brought in journalists from around the world. We laid out this narrative. And then he surprised all the journalists. Apparently, Daimler had outfitted 300, now 400,000 trucks with sensors all over the outside of the truck, and no one knew. They're now all on the expressways of Europe. And these are big data, mobile big data centers. They're picking up traffic conditions, weather conditions, warehouse availability. And this data is being used so they can then partner with thousands of businesses on their logistics to help them with their aggregate efficiencies, their productivity. It's not rocket science. Reduce their marginal costs. It's a new business. Mark Field asked me to join him with Ford on the first day of the auto show, the CEO of Ford in January. We laid out this narrative on the opening day of the International Auto Show, and he announced his mobility internet. Ford is partnering with cities, and with these partnerships, they are going to be providing intermodal transport that will queue in with your apps between the vehicles, the bikes, the trams, all set up. So what I'm saying to you here is it's not either or, it's how do we make a smart transition, and smart industries across these sectors will have to be in two portfolios. Legacy portfolios over the 30 years, sunrise portfolios over the next 30. This is the transition. The last key to this component is all of these three internets ride on top of a platform called the Internet of Things. The Internet of Things is not the cloud, this mysterious abstraction. It's the buildings, the homes, the offices, the factories all over the world. They're going to have to be retrofitted to make them efficient. Then we have to turn them into nodes. Those nodes are going to serve as distributed big data centers, so it's not all centralized in a few monopoly companies. Every building will become a node. It will be a distributed big data center, a micro power generation site around the neighborhood, and a charging station for your vehicles. The nodes connect across countries and continents. It's an interconnected digital infrastructure for a completely new era. And guess what? Everyone under 38 in the millennial generation, they don't need to be retrained. They're digital natives. They just need a new vision, a new story, and a new narrative. And this is common sense. This is the only plan that we know about. We have companies all over the world working this team and scientific institutes. This is the only plan we know about that has any chance, we think, of addressing climate change in time. We're tired of tired little pilot projects that go nowhere. And everybody rewards themselves. We have the bike path in. We've got the new solar building. We have to lay out the infrastructure. Henry Ford could not have created, built his car without electricity for mobile tools. You need an electricity grid. We could not have moved the car without energy from oil pipelines that required national infrastructure. We had to put in the road systems that required eminent domain. Same thing here. We have to put it all in. And let me, in the last few minutes, talk about theory to practice. We spent 17 years in the EU on this plan, and we believe this is the way to move us off carbon quickly. Because if everybody's equipped with a technology that allows us to increase our aggregate efficiency, the ratio of potential to useful work in every conversion, and our productivity, we are really plunging ecological footprint. We're getting more out of less of the earth every time, all right? Everyone's engaged. Sharp technology, mobile. Then if what we do produces shared, share the cars, share the homes, share the children's toys, that means that everything is distributed in a circular system. Nothing goes to the landfill. We're using less of the earth, and we're sharing it more. We go to renewable energy. Everyone should produce their own within 30 years. It's going to be so cheap. And we go to the automated mobility internet, and we can get rid of all those resources we've used in the 20th century auto era. So here's the plan. In February of this year, we announced Smart Europe. The European Central Bank came together and talked about future in 2025. And then I joined with Maro Sefcovic, who's the Vice President of the European Union. He's the head of the Energy Union, Smart Europe, and co-chair with Michael Bloomberg of Global Covenant Cities. And Maro Sefcovic joined with President Markula of the Committee of the Regions, and we announced Smart Europe. We have three test regions already as flagships, so we have a learning laboratory in place, northern France, Hauts-de-France, the industrial area, 23 cities from the Rotterdam to The Hague, and all of Luxembourg. We have a fund of 631 billion euros. That's the Juncker Fund. And much of that fund will be available for infrastructure. We still want to patch up the second industrial revolution infrastructure so it won't collapse, but we should spend at least 50% on the third industrial revolution infrastructure so we can make a new era. Your premier, Trudeau, he's called for $100 billion in infrastructure? $180 billion. So what I'm saying, this is a plea. Patch up the second industrial revolution, its legacy, it's going to be here for a long time. Put some of that money into the third. And the way we're doing it in Europe is Smart Europe. Every region will have to lay out its own customized plan based on this architecture I've laid out, then cross border like Wi-Fi. The nation states and the federal government have to set the codes, the regulations, and the standards. We have a similar plan in Europe. It's called China Internet Plus. It's now operationalizing. Every industry in Canada will be involved in this rollout. ICT, power and utility, electronics, transport and logistics, advanced fabrication manufacturing, construction and real estate to retrofit all the infrastructure. They're all engaged. It's 40 years. And it means jobs. Robots and AI will not transform all your buildings and retrofit and put the insulation in. That's a lot of semi-skilled, skilled work. Robots and AI will not lay down underground 5G cable. That's human beings. Robots and AI will not assemble a wind turbine. That's human beings. Robots and AI will not put in thousands of charging stations. That's human beings. So here's my plea for Canada. I've noticed over the last 40 years I've been involved in this for a while, Canada is always extremely sensitive to the ecosystems they live in. This is a country that's known for its beauty and for preserving and conserving the vast beauty in this last wild part of the world, if you will. So there is a built-in cultural DNA for stewarding the ecosystems of this planet. It's here. It's alive. We need a beachhead in North America. I'm going to be very honest with you. We've got the EU, Smart Europe. We've got China, Internet Plus. We need the Americas, and my hope is that with this new federal government and with all the excitement in the provinces and with your leadership in the side of the environment and energy, we can make this shift. And it can be challenging. It can create new business opportunities. We don't leave anyone behind. We find new business models so the legacy industries over the next 30 years can make the shift into the new business opportunities. And we can provide a lighthouse for all the rest of the Americas. And finally, the legacy you're going to leave here. I'm sure I'm the oldest person here. I'm a World War II baby. You've got to leave this legacy if you're a parent or grandparent. I didn't just throw out that figure about extinction to entertain you. This is real. I started on this, and a lot of folks back in the 70s, we thought we had much more time here. We didn't anticipate the feedback loops, and I'm going to tell you, we are scared to death. We are really frightened about the shift in the water cycles. We've got to be determined. We've got to be committed. We need to move this in three generations. We did the whole first and second industrial revolution infrastructure in 40 years each. We can do this. But now we need bold leadership at the federal government in Canada, the provincial level, and the local level, and show the Americas what can be done, lay out this plan, and move us to more ecological, sustainable planets so those seven generations removed can look back and said, we did the right thing at the important time in history. Thank you.